together. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Worship our King. As we were praying in the back of the room before we came out here, one of the things that I was reminded of is that the Lord deserves all the glory. But you know what? Like, He's going to get His glory regardless of what we do. Not dependent on our response. But the cool part is that we're invited into it. And that the Lord, He's present in the praises of His people. And there's something that's really beautiful that happens, that when we join in the praise and we direct our attention to Him and we give Him glory, I believe that nothing changes with Him. But we just get a greater glimpse. And man, I don't know about you, but I am hungry for a greater glimpse of the Lord. I'm hungry for a greater glimpse of His kingdom. And so, Father, we just even ask that right now, before we even continue, Father, would you help us just to be present? You know, physically, we're settling in, we're here, but God, would you just direct our eyes to you? Would you direct our hearts to you? Father, you get the glory. You deserve the praise. And so would you do the work even now of working through our hearts and our minds, sifting through all the things that get in the way, because you deserve all the glory. We love you, Lord. We say amen. And before we get into song, you guys, I want you to welcome a special friend of ours. She's been part of Harvest for years. Would you guys welcome Meredith Andrews? She's going to be leading us this morning. We're so good to have you here today. So good to be here. Come on, let's worship the Lord together, church. That's why we're here. We're going to lift high the name of Jesus and invite Him to come and do what He wants to do in our hearts today. Come on.
We've seen the things that you have done and seen.
declaration. How y'all doing? It is so good to be here. It's so good to see all of you. I love that God is not finished yet. He's just not. He's not done. Because you're still here, and I'm still here, and we're still here, and we get to be a part of whatever God is doing in the earth. And it was never about a name, never about a church. It was never about any of that. It was always about God's kingdom alive inside of us, His Spirit alive inside of us. And we get to still take ground, take territory. We still get to move forward in His love, by His power. And I know, wow, we've all been through it, hey? Between COVID and whatever is happening in the world. And I've been so encouraged, and God kind of speaks to me repetitiously, like He says the same things over and over again, and maybe it's just because it takes a while for it to really sink in. But I've stayed in 2 Corinthians 4, or I go back to 2 Corinthians 4 quite often, because I love that whole chapter. But at the end, what it says is, outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. And these light and momentary afflictions are achieving for us an eternal weight of glory that far outweighs them all. And so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Because what is seen is temporary, meaning it's not gonna last very long. It's like grains of sand sifting through our hands. But what is unseen is eternal. And I want to live for the unseen. And I know it's easy to get our eyes on what's going on around us in the natural and feel overwhelmed and feel like, God, I don't know how much more of this I can take. I don't really understand what you're doing. I don't really see you working. But that's where we have to go back to His word and remember His promises. That's where we have to remember who we are in Him. And that He's actually called us to advance the kingdom of God in the earth. We're not just sitting here waiting for a rapture. We're actually bringing the kingdom of heaven to earth. That is the mandate for the church. And how do we do that? We cling to Him with all that we are. We don't try to carry all this stuff on our own. We don't try to, you know, drag this ball and chain around, because we were never meant to live in that kind of bondage with that kind of weight. We were always meant to cast our cares on Him because He cares for us. We were always meant to lay our burdens at His feet because His yoke is easy and His burden is light. And today I want to sing a new song over you guys that's not yet released. And everybody, the team has been so gracious for me just to come and be with y'all and sing this over you. But it really is that idea that we were never meant to carry the world, the weight of the world. He's got it. He's sovereign. He's on His throne. No matter what happens, we just have to keep lifting our eyes. We have to keep fixing our eyes. It's a choice. I will choose to praise. I will choose to lift my eyes to the author, to the finisher of my faith, who will be faithful to the very end. Amen. Amen. You can have a seat if you'd like. Let me just sing this over you. This is Carry the World.
When the weight of everything feels heavy. Well, praise the Lord, Harvest. Our God is able to do great things. The things that we see as insurmountable, God is able to just take care of that for us. Let's always remember that, all right? My name is Ramirez. I serve as the Associate Campus Pastor here at our Rolling Meadows campus. And it's so great to see you and to worship with you this morning. If this is your first time joining us, I want to extend a very special welcome to you. And just know that you're amongst a welcoming people. I'm one of them, and I love the opportunity to meet you after service. I'll be in the lobby. And while you have your, if this, whether this is your first time or you join us every week, I want to invite you to check in. You could do that using the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We not only want to know what you're here today, but we'd also like to know how we could be praying for you this week. Our staff counts it a great joy to pray for the people in our church. And while you have your phone out, we have an opportunity to give. And as followers of Jesus Christ, we give as an act of worship to Him. He's entrusted us with resources. And so now is our opportunity in faith to give back to Him for that. And so if you look at the screen, you'll see the different options that you have to give in addition to giving on the app, or you can drop your gift in the blue boxes as you leave the worship center today. Harvest, we have a very special night coming up on Thursday, July 28th. It's called Seek Night. And this is the night where we have an opportunity to seek the Lord through worship and also through prayer. It's happening this Thursday at 7 o'clock here at the Rolling Meadows campus. Don't miss that. It's a great time to worship and pray with God's people in God's house. Man, Harvest, man, we today have the privilege of celebrating something awesome. God has moved in an amazing way in the last 20 years at Camp Harvest. Yeah, it's been 20 years. Can you believe that? And when camp opened up July 2002, we didn't see all that we had in store ahead of us. And so today we want to celebrate the last 20 years, but we also want to celebrate the many years to come. So will you join me as we pray for that? Lord, we thank You for all that You've done at Camp Harvest and the many lives that You've changed. I've had some incredible experiences, and I know that everyone in this room could say the same. God, we are thankful for Your goodness in that. And so, God, we're also praising You for the things that You are still yet to do at camp. And so, God, will You just continue to have Your way at camp? Continue to change lives in the way that only You can. In Jesus' name, amen. And so, guys, we want to continue to celebrate all that God has done at camp. So this month's God at Work video is on Camp Harvest. So check this out.
The concept of Camp Harvest came from a bunch of people in student ministry talking about how camp has impacted each one of us and wouldn't it be great to have a camp of our own. And so I remember praying and investigating and talking to different camps, and then God showed up and provided us a place that we now call Camp Harvest just north of Grand Rapids, Michigan.
I remember getting there and just seeing this magnificent piece of property that the Lord had provided. And long before we even imagined where the first cabin would even be, we just stopped and prayed about the changes and what He would do in the lives of the people that would step on there.
Camp is a unique environment. You get kids away from the distractions of life. When they first get there and you're like, all right, no phones, and they all groan like, no phones, how am I going to live without my... And then a day or two later, the guards come down, personalities come out, and God uses those moments.
I was always amazed at how different people with very different backgrounds and very different attitudes could have such a blast at Camp Harvest. And we got to know people that we thought, like, Wow, we haven't talked to that kid all year long at youth group, but here up at camp, all of a sudden we really started this relationship. A lot of my lifelong friendships that I still have, honestly, were relationships that were built at that place.
I went to camp the first year as a camper in sixth grade and met like all of my small group girls, and we're still, for the most part, all together. So it's been really cool to be able to grow together.
94% of people who come to faith do so in their teen years. And so like these years, I think we have long seen the importance of withdrawing and having space to be able to literally put your phone in a box for a week and see God work.
Your encounters with God can become predictable when your life is so scheduled. But when you're at camp, you're watching him show up in unpredictable ways, unscheduled ways.
We saw like a lot of families coming together, learning about what it means to be following the Lord as a family, and they just feeling the presence of the Lord there in the camp.
These campers worship different than when we would hear them worship at weekly ministry. It was the presence of God was there.
There's something like sacred about that basement. Just all the times like I've encountered God in that space, you can feel his presence.
It's some of my favorite worship. Something about just like the white words on a black screen TV. It's just like not a huge show.
We've had students come in who have just struggled behaviorally. They've struggled to get along, they've struggled to fit in, they've struggled with addiction, they've struggled with so many things. And then to watch throughout the week, not only their behavior change, their heart change, their countenance changes, the way that they interact with other students changes, their literal lives are being transformed.
There's miracles, you see miracles. You see students being brought from death to life, from darkness to light. I've known people who have come here with no church background and they leave on fire for Jesus.
You could be a helper in the kitchen. You could be a worship leader. You could be a leader of just a cabin. Kind of didn't matter who you were. Like, you were going to encounter the Holy Spirit. You were going to walk into this property and be blown away.
You just get a front row seat for an entire summer, seeing both students you know and students you don't know make these huge gains in their walk that you wouldn't get to see anywhere else.
People always startled when all of a sudden kids show up and make a noise. But to me, that noise is a joyful noise. And having a Christian camp here is a blessing to our community.
There's nothing particularly special about this place, but it's a place where God shows up year after year and life after life.
There's nothing in the lodge or the basement that is a spiritual recipe for success. It's everyone coming here expecting to see the Lord move. When you go home, like, you don't have to look back and say, oh, I wish I could be at Camp Harvest. You can have the same posture of your heart to the Lord.
So many of those lessons I learned from John Smith, from my youth pastors, from the leaders that were pouring into me, God really used that and taught me a lot that I've seen just flow throughout all of my ministry life and opportunities, being a youth pastor, and now even a campus pastor.
Even in my walk today, when I like feel far from him, I can always kind of like take myself back to what it feels like in that basement, to what it feels like in that cabin, and just remember and recount like all the ways that God has met me. You can't ever really forget that experience.
I've been to other camps, I've done other ministry, and Camp Harvest will always be the most special to me. There's just no place like it on earth.
Still today you hear people say, when did you give your life to Christ? At Camp Harvest. When did you make that turn in your life? At Camp Harvest. What was a significant spiritual at Camp Harvest? To think that the Lord would allow a piece of property to be so greatly used. What a powerful testimony to the work of the Lord.
We're excited to be able to this summer look back on the last 20 years and see over 30,000 kids that have come to camp. About 3,500 kids have accepted Christ here for the first time. To celebrate how much God has moved in this property and just in this place. And at the same time, grow with excitement that we get to do this for another 20 years.
What's next is hopefully more of the same, more of the 20 years of awesome ministry that's already happened
here. God changing lives.
Hey, church family, it's awesome to celebrate what God has been doing at Camp Harvest and look forward to all the things that he's going to do. And we're excited to celebrate what God has been doing in so many people's lives. So today I'm joined by Aurora. Aurora is joining us all the way from Canada today and has been waiting for this day to be baptized for a year. So we are super excited for you.
Yes, thank you.
Aurora, can you just tell us, how did you come to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Before my life, 5.5 years ago, I felt like my life is incomplete. There's something missing. And I finally surrender everything to Him because I cannot rely on my own strength anymore. Mm-hmm. That's when I said to myself, God, I fully surrender to You.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. That is so awesome. Yeah. So, Aurora, why do you want to get baptized today?
I want to publicly profess that I will follow Jesus, and I want to celebrate new life in Christ.
That's right. So, all right, Aurora. Well, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's my privilege to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Absolutely. And this is Violet Lewis. We have a small army of students coming to be baptized today. Violet, can you share just how you came to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I was in Awana, and my leader talked about sharing God into your heart. So when I went home, I talked to my parents, and I was like, I would love to get baptized today. Accept God in my heart.
That's right. And so you decided to follow Him for the rest of your life. That's awesome. So why do you want to get baptized today, Violet?
I want to get baptized today to show people that I will do anything to keep God's word going on and forever.
Yep. All right. Well, Violet, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, it's my privilege to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, and this is Libby Asper. Hey, Libby. Libby, would you just tell everyone how you came to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I came to know Jesus because of Awana right before COVID hit in February of 2020.
And how did you decide that you wanted to follow Him?
Because I grew up in a Christian house, so I already knew that He was going to be a big part of my life. So when I had the opportunity to do it, so I just took it because I knew I wanted to be with Jesus for the rest of my life.
That's right. And so, Libby, why do you want to be baptized today?
Because Jesus said to in the Bible to publicly proclaim your faith in Him.
That's right. Well, Libby, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's my privilege to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
That's awesome.
All right, this is Liv Lindstrom. Hey, Liv.
Hi.
Liv, how did you come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
I grew up in a Christian home, so I've always, known Jesus, but I accepted Him my first year at Camp Harvest in sixth grade.
All right. And why do you want to get baptized today, Liv?
To publicly proclaim my faith of Jesus.
And you want to follow Him for the rest of your life?
Yes.
That's right. Well, Liv, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's my privilege to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, this is Mary Hammond. Hey, Mary. Mary, how'd you come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
I was 4 years old when I accepted Christ with my dad. And then it became more personal when I went to camp in sixth grade. And rather than something that I just knew about, it was more of a relationship.
That's awesome. And why do you want to get baptized today, Mary?
I want to show everyone that I believe in God, and I felt convicted at camp to get baptized, so I want to obey Him.
Amen. All right, Mary. Well, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right. All right, everyone, this is Adrian. Hey, Adrian. Adrian, how did you come to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I gave my life to Christ when I was in third grade. It was after Harvest Kids, and they asked if you have a personal relationship with God. And then as I thought about it, I didn't know if I did. And I went home, and my mom walked me through how to give my life to Christ.
Amen. You put your faith in Him on that day. That is so awesome. And so, Adrian, why do you want to get baptized today?
Because I want to show everybody that Jesus Christ is my Savior.
That's right. And you're going to follow Him the rest of your life, right?
Yes.
All right. Well, Adrian, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, this is Hannah Weber. Hey, Hannah. Hannah, how'd you come to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I grew up in a Christian household, so God was like always, you know, on the topic. I committed my life to Jesus when I was 6, but I felt like afterwards I didn't really feel Him, or like really put all my trust in Him. So this year at camp, I rededicated my life to Jesus at Camp Harvest.
Amen. That is so awesome.
Buddy, he's my Savior, and I love Him.
That's right. And so why do you want to get baptized today?
I want to publicly proclaim my love for Jesus Christ.
All right, Hannah. Well, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I now baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right. All right. We're going to invite down Pastor Dave Lernon. He's got some special people that he's going to baptize today.
Yeah, we're excited about each person, and this is my daughter, Malia. And Malia, we would love to just hear, when was it that you trusted Jesus as your Savior?
It was around Christmas time when I was 4 years old.
Uh-huh. What was going on?
We were watching a Christmas movie, and afterwards I asked you if you would help me tell Jesus that I want a relationship with Him.
Awesome. And it's because you know you need a Savior, right? Mm-hmm. And Jesus is the way?
Yeah.
Awesome. Why do you want to get baptized now?
Because, like Larry taught us at camp, that once you are saved, then you must identify with Christ through baptism, and I want to do that.
Perfect. That sounds like an awesome thing to do today, Malia. We're praying for you and cheering for you, and because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And this is Sophia. Sophia, we'd love to hear, when was it that you made a personal decision to trust Jesus as your Savior?
When I was about 4 or 5, I asked my mom if she would like pray with me so that I could trust Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And then she prayed with me, and then that's when I made the decision to trust God.
Amazing. It can't be mom and dad's thing, right? It's got to be yours. Is it yours?
Yep.
Awesome. And why do you want to get baptized today?
Because that's how we identify with Christ, and I want to do that.
Perfect. Sounds good to me, Sophia. Sophia, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior, we have the privilege of baptizing you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
If I'm gonna be able to make it through this song. After this song, I need y'all to help me. Come on, let's stand and worship the Lord. Thank you. so stirred within us just because of who you are and all that you've done and all that you are still doing. And we just declare and we thank you that you are still the God who works miracles. You are still the God who raises the dead back to life. You are still the one who sets us free, as we have seen evidence of today. And we are so grateful that your kingdom is coming and your kingdom is here. When we say, Lord, your will be done, your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven, receive all the glory and honor and power and wisdom and strength to your name and your name alone. Jesus, we love you. We love you. Would you speak to our hearts? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Come on, give him praise one more time. So good to worship him. Hey, receive our praise, God. It's all for you. Receive it all. People said together, amen. So good to worship the Lord together. You'll go ahead and take a seat.
To see you. It's great to have the rest of you join us by the brilliance of video. Great to be here in Elgin. God bless you. I've been gone the last few weeks. I was in Canada, so there's lots of stories about that you'll hear over the next year. No, it was great. It was great to see some friends and family. It was great also to be able to have lots of our budding preachers get an opportunity, so I really appreciate your support for them, and I'm excited to see how God uses them in the days ahead. But for today, what I want to do is I actually want to study in a new series that we're starting today in Psalm 121. It's actually a series that I'll talk about in a second called the Psalms of Ascent. The Psalms of Ascent. So Psalm 121. While you're turning there, let me tell you one of my favorite things to do in my life is actually to frighten my wife. She is delightful, and it never gets old. Sometimes I throw water on her in the shower, and she screams bloody murder, and I just laugh and laugh. I'm a good husband. One of my favorite things to do in days gone by, though, when we didn't have children, is that sometimes we'd go and watch these movies that were really, you know, like had a scary thriller. We're not really horror movie people, but you get these movies that have kind of a, you know, a scary animal or something that's chasing everybody around. And as soon as we'd come home, I'd pretend to be that animal and chase her around. And she would yell, "Stop, stop, what are you doing?" And I'd hide quietly until I could scare the living daylights out of her. The movie that really got me started on that was Jurassic Park. Some of you guys remember that. Of course, Jurassic World's around now. And it was the first time we were ever introduced to velociraptors. And I thought that's the perfect animal for me to be in the house when in the dark. So I remember we watched the movie, and we were staying actually at my in-law's parsonage. That's if you're new to church, that's a word that refers to when a church owns a house that's next to the church. And the pastor lives there. That's called the parsonage. Well, my father-in-law and mother-in-law, they lived in this parsonage, which was right next door to a church in eastern Washington State, which is in the middle of wheat fields. Wheat field, church, parsonage, wheat field, that kind of thing, okay? And the wheat would grow up, quite high. And have you ever seen alien movies? All the alien movies, there's always wheat around them, and the aliens are in the wheat, and they are. That's exactly what this place was like. In the middle of, honestly, if you drove out there, you'd be like, this is the middle of nowhere. There is nothing anywhere around here. And so at night, you could hear the whistling, the coyotes in the distance, and the whistling wind. And this was a perfect opportunity to be the velociraptor. And so my wife and I were staying there, because her parents were out of town, and we were staying there, and that house was old and creaky. It was an old farmhouse, and I started to, wander around the house and hide in different rooms, and she'd be like, Jeff, Jeff? You know, she has this fear that the rapture is going to happen and she's not going. And so sometimes that's what she's like, oh, no. But I would just hide around corners and try to scare the living daylights out of her and try to jump on her. I actually had a friend one time say to me, why in the world would you do that? I said, because I can. But that fear of being alone, right, of facing a danger and having nobody else around is really, like when they do the hierarchy of fears in people's lives, right, it is very near the top. Public speaking, top, right? And then fear of being alone, especially when something bad happens, which is why all the horror movies are dumb, right? Because everyone's like, let's split up. Shut up, that's stupid. What are you talking about? You know, split up. You stick together because everybody's scared to death of being alone. You see the movie Castaway? It's an old one, Tom Hanks, right? He's so scared of being alone, he turns a volleyball into a guy. Paints a face on him and talks about it to him about it because we're so afraid of that loneliness. What we need in our lives is actually companionship, but the kind of companionship that's capable of handling the harms that are heading our way, because there are harms heading our way. And we know it. We need someone who's going to be with us all the time, who both has the power to deal with those harms and also the care for us. So that when they come, they don't just abandon. That's what this passage is about. Psalm 121 is basically a massive reminder that God watches over his people. That the Lord is with us as his people, that the Lord cares for his people, he has power to help his people. And in order to get that point across, it's just like one point, right? But in order to get that point across, the psalmist, he kind of uses all these images. That's the beauty of psalms, right? They're songs. So they use imagery and they compare God to certain things or use pictures in order for you to understand who God is and what he's like. So there are five different pictures that are in this psalm that I want to walk through, five of them that make one point, and that is that God is with you everywhere you go. He looks after us everywhere he go. And then at the end, I want to just say, okay, so what does that mean for us, like really practically speaking? How should a psalm like this affect us, all right? So here's the first of the five images, the mountains. The mountains. These are the Psalms of Ascent over the next few weeks. That's the series that we're in. Brand new this week. The Psalms of Ascent are the songs that the people of Israel used to sing on their way to worshiping God at the temple in Jerusalem. And in order to get to the temple, you would have to ascend the mountain of the Lord. You'd have to ascend Mount Zion. And so they're like pilgrim songs, where they all sing these together and they get to the top of the mountain along the way. And so a lot of the imagery that's used in them is actually really important for people who are walking on narrow pathways and are facing the challenges of a long pilgrimage or a long caravan or something like that. So here's Psalm 121. I lift my eyes to the hill. From where does my help come from? It's interesting he talks about the hills. When you're standing in the valley before you go up to Jerusalem, there's all sorts of different mountains, peaks that are kind of around there. And if you go to any old city in the ancient world, the high places, right, the tops of the hills, are always where the gods were worshipped, right? If you have a really good God, you know, and you name him Shemahosaphat or whatever, and you say, okay, I'm going to put my God Shemahosaphat, and he's going to be up, you always want to find the highest hill to prove what? He's the best one. If you can go to the highest hill, your God is the highest God. So what would happen is if you stood in a valley and you looked around and there were peaks around you, and by peaks, please don't understand, like these aren't the Rockies peaks. These are like, you know, what people on the East Coast called mountains, which are like little bumps, okay? Like people here in Illinois, that's a mountain. No, that's just a bump, okay? But you'd put your temple on top of that bump. And so And so I totally got lost because my mind is thinking to myself about that little, we call their little bump by the airport, Mount Illinois, because it's the biggest thing we've seen in the whole state at this point. So you're standing in the valley and you're looking up all of these hills and you're asking the question, all right? There's a God up in there, there's a God up there, there's a God up there, and there's a God up there. You're asking the question, from where does my help come? And what you're essentially saying is, which one of these gods can I trust to provide for me what I need? Now, his answer, of course, is, well, my help comes from the Lord. Why? Well, he made the heaven and the earth. And the people, if you make something, you have ownership over it. Everything you see, the mountains that they see, that the other gods are sitting on, were made by Yahweh. They wouldn't even be up there if Yahweh hadn't made the hill. So where does my help come from? My help comes from the biggest, baddest, best God there is on the highest mountain, Mount Zion, because he made everything, and therefore he owns everything, and he can do everything. There's another psalm that really gets at this image. Put not your trust in princes. I always feel like I need to contextualize that for us. The Obamas, Bidens, Trumps, whatever, politics, I don't care who it is. Don't put your trust in princes, in the great leaders of our day, and the ones who promise you that, oh, this is going to be great. I got a system. It's going to solve everything for you forever and ever and ever, right? You'll own nothing and be happy. Okay? Put not your trust in princes, in a son of man, in whom there is no salvation. Well, why is there no salvation? Well, when his breath departs, he returns to the earth. On that very day, his plans, they perish. So he's got a termination date. Every great person has a moment where they don't breathe anymore, and then at that point, all of their plans are up to the next people who might not even share them. They might actually have the desire to undo them all, right? We know this. Every 4 years, the president comes in. I'm going to write every executive order and wipe everything out that the guy did before me. Right. So don't put your trust in princes. But blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God. Why? Well, he made the heaven and the earth. Sound familiar? The sea and all that's in them. Who keeps faith forever. I mean, he's going to be counted on all the time. There's never a termination date. And everything you see around you is a product of his ability. So in the grand scheme of all the options that you have to provide for you, and I know we don't have like gods on hills and stuff, but we sure do look to gods like money, don't we? We look to other things. I have insurance for that. The suburbs are basically our approach to trying to protect our lives from all the harms, yes? Okay, no? That's why you have a garage, so you can close them out behind you. You go in, you close them, you go inside and watch TV. They can't get you there. Nothing bad will happen inside your suburban home. So we have our own little gods, our own little ways that we trust. We think, oh, we can take care of ourselves or whatever, but this psalmist basically saying, no, you can't. Your gods won't help. The only one that will help is the Lord Yahweh. I do want to press this just for a second. No one else, the argument here is no one else, none of those other options have the ability to control the coming harms. You ever thought to yourself, why is it that idolatry is a thing? Why is it that throughout the history of the world, people choose to worship certain deities and certain things? They even make like little statues to them. Why do people go to the tarot card reader? What are they trying to do? If you go into villages in Africa, you'll meet people who are called witch doctors. Why do people visit the witch doctor? What are they after? Well, here's how it works. One of the common things that everybody in the history of the world has faced is harms, right? There are things out there that we do not control that will come into our lives and destroy stuff, right? Like kids. Or COVID, or a virus, or whatever the government's doing recently, or war, or the economy, or. When you get worried at night or during the day, you're worrying because there's a whole bunch of stuff out there that you don't control that if it gets in, it's going to ruin everything. And the fact that you can't control it is a real issue. So all these harms are invading or threatening to invade, and you need to get control over those particular harms. So how do you do it? You know your limitations. What you need is Superman, right? You need Aquaman. By the way, Aquaman, what a weaking. You need Batman who gets beat up all the time. No, you need someone who's got ability, greater power than 11. You need 11. You need somebody who's going to come and going to help. Stranger Things. Okay? You need somebody who's going to be able to come and help you. And so what you do is you end up putting your trust in an idol, a Baal, or for us, money. I just have enough money, then I'll have enough insurance that everything that happens to me can be taken care of, right? But, of course, then there's cancer. So we're looking for something outside of us that has control and power and ability to take care of us. And so we try to find it through the witch doctor. We try to find it through money. Or we try to find it through a myriad of other things. But there's only one who can do it. I lift my eyes up to the hills. From where does my help come out of all of these options? From the Lord only. He's the only one that can take care of us. So the psalmist is drawing our attention to the mountains. This is the first picture, okay? The mountains. Here's the second one. A slipping foot. He will not let your foot be moved. He will not. So the image here is the people of Israel as they walk up this treacherous path ascending to Jerusalem. The path is not always, it's not I-90, okay? It's like roads in you know, third world countries, or where I lived in New Zealand. They're horrible roads. They just wind back and forth and they go down massive cliffs and there's no guardrails and everything. You're like, oh my goodness, we're all gonna die. That's what it's like, except you're walking up there. And if your foot hits, you know, a rock that is a little uneasy, you're done. You're going down, baby. And so this image for a pilgrim is like, the Lord won't let my foot slip. It's a picture that means a lot to them as they're walking along. He won't let my foot slip. Because then God is securing my feet, I can be bold, right? Let's just think this through with me for a minute. Years ago, there was an article in the Vancouver Sun, kind of Vancouver, British Columbia. We don't get a lot of ice there. It's like Seattle where it just rains constantly. So when we have ice storms or whatever, the Vancouver Sun, it's like the Chicago Sun-Times or whatever, they publish articles that say, okay, so here's how you walk on ice. Like front page, you know, somebody standing there on ice or like, woo-hoo. Here's how you walk on ice. You have to waddle. Everyone from the middle of Canada is like, oh, come on, really? We have to have an article for this? Well, yes, because you have to waddle, take really slow steps. The most important thing when you're walking on ice is to be very, very careful and slow and deliberate and make sure that each foot is solidly planted before the next one goes down. Right, that's very different, though, from walking on the hard ground in the middle of the summer on a flat piece of property, right, on a soccer field, where you just run. You don't even think about where your feet are hitting because you're just going, there's the ball, I'm going for it, you know. You're bold. You're bold on the solid ground. You're really skittish on the ice, Right, so that's the picture that the psalmist is trying to convey here. If your feet aren't slipping, why in the world would you be weak or passive or not bold in your walking, in your striving, in your faith? Why would you do that at all? It makes no sense. Can you imagine walking out to a soccer field and someone's like, I don't want to trip. I don't want to trip. No, run, man, run. It's safe. Your feet won't slip. Okay, so I mentioned the roads in New Zealand. One of my worst moments, okay? I fully admit it. My in-laws, the ones who lived in the parsonage, they came over to New Zealand when we lived there, and there is a road that goes over this hill from what's called Tasman Bay to Golden Bay. It's called the Takaka Hill, okay? And the road does this up the side of the hill, over, and then the other side. Now, we've driven this road lots of times, and my car totally handles it. And I'm a guy, so, you know, you make a game out of it. Ready, go, right? You drive as fast as you can, right? Now, it's just me and my wife. All I have to deal with her is saying, stop, and I'm like, whatever, you're fine. Now, but we, you know, when somebody comes to New Zealand, we want to take them over to Golden Bay because it's idyllic, it's beautiful. Okay, my in-laws came, we start driving, and I'm like, okay, ready, go. And we start driving, and the, you know, when you go the corners, there is, it goes straight down, and there's no guardrails at all. And my mother-in-law is sitting over the wheel that's sometimes going into the ditch and back up while we're going around these corners. So she's sort of hanging, looking straight down, and she's like, oh, I'm not feeling good. And my father-in-law's like, perhaps you could slow down. Uh-huh. It's still doing it. Why? I'm not going to slow down. I know exactly how well this car is going to be able to handle this. I've done this dozens of times. It's fine. Well, she eventually threw up. Again, my father-in-law said, why did you drive so fast? And I said, because I can, right? And I can. I'm a great son-in-law, too. Just and husband, son-in-law. The reason I can is because I know the grippiness of the tires, and I've been through this way before. This is the image that he's after, is that if you know that you are going to be safe, if you know that you are taken care of and that your foot will never slide in such a way that you will be, you know, left into the ditch, if you know that the tires will always grip, you don't drive it like a golf cart. Right? You drive it like a Lamborghini. And yet, so many of us in our Christian faith, right? We are a bunch of golf cart driving Christians. I don't know, the Lord, I don't know. It's going to be really hard. Come on, get out there. Hit the gas. Go, baby. Right? Your foot won't slip. He's got it. The third one. It's about a sleeping guard. Right? Behold, he who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. He's not going to be asleep at the wheel. He's not going to be, when you need him, he's not going to be over there, like your friends would be. You ever have that friend that sleeps, all the other ones you played all the pranks on when you went and had the sleepovers, you know, with the toothpaste and everything? He'll sleep through anything. That's not the Lord. He won't sleep through anything. And because he never sleeps, you and I can sleep. Because he never sleeps, you and I can sleep. You know, I didn't get an opportunity to talk a lot about my favorite parts about Elijah. Because I left, and the best parts of Elijah got to be preached by others. So one of my favorite passages in Elijah really makes the point that our God is different than all the other gods in this sense. He's there, and he answers. You don't need to scream and yell and freak out or anything like that. He's there, and he answers. And this is really becomes apparent when Elijah sets up this big fight between Elijah and his prophets of Baal. He's got 400 and something prophets of Baal there. He says, okay, we're going to set up this contest. And this is what happens when they decide to set up the contest. Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, choose for yourselves one bull and prepare it first. for your many, right? It's like 450 to one. How do I even have a chance, says Elijah? You are many and call upon the name of your God. Hey, but don't cheat. Put no fire on it. Don't you get over there with your little matches, your Bic light, or don't you do it. So they were like, okay, they took the bowl that was given them and they prepared it and they called upon the name of Baal from morning until noon. That's a good session, right? If you know anything about Baal worship, one of the ways they worshiped was by whipping and beating themselves to the point of blood. And so they would like, look how much we care. And they had these little chants and stuff. And so you can imagine for 3 hours listening to this. Well, that's Elijah. And they were saying, oh, Baal, answer us. Oh, Baal, answer us. But look, there was no voice. And no one answered. And they limped around the altar. Isn't that a great image? Like zombies going around the altar that they had made. And at noon, Elijah, my man, right? He starts mocking them. God bless him, right? He starts mocking them saying, hey, maybe you should cry aloud, but he's a God, right? He's there. You should yell. He's a God. He should probably be able to hear you guys, right? He's super powerful. Maybe he's musing. He's thinking. He's in his study. Don't bother me. I'm trying to figure out, you know, the law of thermodynamics here. He's either musing or he's, and I won't go into much detail here. He's in the porta potty. I don't know. You know, every father knows this. Would you just leave me alone? I just want these men. Maybe that's Baal. Or he's on a journey. Or perhaps he's asleep and he has to be awakened. Right? That's all the other gods need help. All the other gods need rest. All the other gods need to have a time where they get away and they don't have aren't bothered by anything. Not Yahweh. He never slumbers nor sleeps. And like I said, because he never slumbers nor sleeps, you and I can. Listen, even the one story I know about in Scripture where God is sleeping, it proves that he never sleeps. I know, it sounds weird. But there is a story where Jesus is asleep. And the story itself actually points to the same conclusion that the Psalm 121 says. On that day, when evening had come, he said to them being the disciples, let's go across to the other side. They're going to go across to the Sea of Galilee. Notice that he does not say at this particular moment, hey guys, let's go out in the middle and we're going to drown. You good? No, the plan is spoken by the Lord of the universe. We're going to the other side. Leaving the crowd, they took him with them in their boat just as he was, and other boats were with them. And a great windstorm arose. You've probably heard this before, but in the Sea of Galilee, the winds come down suddenly, and they come through the valley, and they just blow across the sea, sometimes with like 10-foot swells, break into the towns on the shores. So these are largely fishermen. These people who've grown up around this lake, okay? These are like the people who live, you know, in Skokie or whatever, and like, this, I understand the Lake Michigan. She's a stormy seed, and like that, those people, right? They get their livelihood from this water, so they understand, you know, when it's getting bad. A great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. But Jesus, he was in the stern. That's the back, and he was asleep on the cushion. And they woke him and said the thing that you and I always want to say to God when we get in a situation where everything's going haywire and we're screaming out like the prophets of Baal and God isn't answering. Because we think he's asleep in slumber and we're like, you're not supposed to be asleep or slumber. They woke him and said, teacher, don't you care that we're perishing?
Somebody who cared about us would be actively up here and bailing the water out. You should be helping. Instead, you're sleeping. Get up! And he awoke. And he rebuked the wind. You rebuke people. You rebuke, like, persons. Like, demons can be rebuked and people can be rebuked. Jesus gets up and is like, hey, wind! Knock it off! And he said to the sea, out to the sea, hey, you too! Stop it! And the wind ceased. There was a great calm. And then he said to them, well, why are you so afraid? Don't you still have faith? Isn't it crazy that you've got Jesus in the boat and he's asleep in the midst of a storm and they are freaking out? What is the difference between these two people? Well, according to Jesus, he understood who he was and where they were headed and that it was sure and that his father wasn't going to leave in the middle of the ocean or middle of the sea and they were going to die. That wasn't in the cards. So you might as well just lay your head down and be fine with it. The others are like, oh no, it's all going wrong. Which one of those do you think you look like when things are going wrong? I know which one I do. Jesus. That's the one I look like. Look, even though the point, it's easy to see what the point is. Even though it looked like God wasn't caring for them, he was. He was. Jesus' father never sleeps, so Jesus could sleep. And those who follow him are guaranteed the same provision. So sleep. Some of you really need to hear that, you know that. Lay your head on the pillow, realize your limitations, look to the mountains, see which one can care for you, and doze away. Here's the fourth one. It's shade, like an umbrella, okay? The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade in your right hand. You see that? That's like you and I walking around with our umbrella, or you go golfing and people put it on their little golf thing so that they don't get the sun down on them. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. Now, I'm going to explain to you in a second why it's the moon is involved here. But you understand that the sun, the dangers that the sun would have, especially if you are a pilgrim and you're walking up this hill. For you and me, the danger is usually, I don't want to get a sunburn. But for them, actually, the danger was, I don't want to get, like, dehydrated. I don't want to get sunstroke so that I start seeing vision. So I need protection from the sun so that I can move forward and be safe from all of the harmful effects. As you can see, it's the same kind of image that we've gone through so far. So God is like the umbrella that, or the big shade tree, or the palm that is providing you safety as you move forward. He guards you from the sun and by the moon. Now, when I read that, I'm like, really? We need to be guarded by the moon? In ages gone by, people believed that when the moon came out and it was a full moon, weird things happened. Actually, when my kids were really little and we were over someone else's house and they were running like crazy because it was like 9 at night and they were like, ah! I said, whoa, they're really crazy. And the person whose house we were at were, it's a full moon. I'm like, oh, why? They believed actually that, look, when the full moon comes out, they turn into werewolves and they start attacking everything. Right? You're moonstruck. That's the language you use. We're moonstruck. We do it for like romantic things, but you hear the image. The language comes from somewhere, and for ages past, they believed that. And certainly in the ancient world, that's something they believe. So the sun has power to harm you, and the moon has power to harm you, and both of them the Lord protects us from. This sun and moon, it's what we call a merism. The argument is, It's not just the sun, it's not just the moon, it's both of those and everything in between. So what is there to harm you? What is it that God can't protect you from? And the answer is nothing. We get the same argument in Romans 8:37. No, in all these things we're more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm sure, now notice the merisms, that neither death nor life and everything in between, nor angels nor rulers and everything in between, nor things present nor things to come and everything in between, nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Right, that's the image. God's our shade. Last one, he's the one who keeps us in a sense that he watches over us. He's our guard. He's our guardian. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in. It doesn't matter what stage you're in your life, whether you're going out and you're going to college, or you're coming in at Thanksgiving, or you're going out to find a spouse, or you're coming back in because you found one. You're going out because your spouse died, or you're coming back in because you got remet. All of the stages of life, all of them. The Lord will keep you. The word keep actually means to watch over you. It's language that's used of like how a gardener takes particular care for their garden. And by gardener, I mean like a golf course, like groundskeeper. When I was in New Zealand, I actually, it was the only time in my life I ever did any gardening. My wife said, oh, this is going to be great for the rest of our lives. And I was like, nope, this is the only time this ever happens, okay? I'm going to take care of this garden. Because everywhere in New Zealand, that's what you did. You go to work, you come home, and you work on your garden. So, you know, want to be contextualized, and I did that, moved a bunch of dirt around, had it designed professionally by a friend of mine, and I went through with it. But when you put that much work in something, you take a lot of care of it. And so there was these little weeds that they had in the grass called paspalum there. It was a different kind of grass, but it looked weird and funky. It was not the grass that I wanted there. And so I would go, no kidding, in the evenings with my I had a little pocket knife, and I'd walk around the lawn looking back and forth for any little tiny pieces of paspalum. And when I saw one, I'd get down on my hands and knees, and I'd cut it out. Like, what an idiot. And I'm walking around on the lawn with my knife in my hand. You know, if you would sign me, what is he doing? Right? Well, I was so concerned about this lawn. Well, yeah, I was watching over it. I was watching. Have you played Capture the Flag? You know, when you're the prison keeper or you're the flag guardian? Yes, Capture the Flag? I'm getting a lot of response from you guys right now. Capture the Flag, you know, 20 years of camp. Okay, we're all into it. Okay, so Capture the Flag, and you have to play the flag keeper. You're the head. Your head's on a swivel because they come from everywhere. All those people coming to get your flag. Yeah, the guardian. You're watching over the flag. You're keeping the flag. And this is the point of the whole psalm. If this sounds repetitive to you, it should. The psalmist is trying to say, how many times do I need to say this so that you actually understand it? He who keeps you, verse 3, will not slumber. The Lord is your keeper, in verse 5. The Lord will keep you. He will keep your life. He will keep your going out and your coming in. Do you get it? He is with you, watching over you wherever you go and whatever you do. So what? Okay, I got all the images. I understand what the psalm is trying to say, and it's poetry. And so what's supposed to happen when I read you poetry or sing you a song is you're supposed to feel something, right? That's why you write the song for her. That's why you did it. You got on, I love you, you're so pretty. Like, you want her to feel it. That's why you put it into verse. So this is in verse. This is why the Bible's filled with songs and psalms. It's supposed to make touch your affections. So what is it supposed to make you feel? Two things. One, it's supposed to make you feel boldness, right? I mentioned that a minute ago. It's supposed to make you feel like, okay, if the Lord is watching over me and all of these things are true about God and my relationship to him, why am I so afraid to go forward and take risks? Why am I backing down so much when it comes to the space? Oh, yeah. Oh, you're in trouble now, right? The handheld one. Why am I so worried about the spending, giving to the Lord or seeing how he could provide for my life or going here or there or doing whatever it is that he calls me to do? Look, I'll make the argument for you, okay? I believe that in order for you and I to have boldness in any circumstance, what we need is someone with us who has both power and concern for us so that we can go forward and do the thing that we're being called to do. You need accompaniment by somebody both with power and concern. Because here's why. Look, if I have a friend and they're with me and I say, okay, by the way, alone, you don't have a lot of courage. You know that. You know that. But if I'm with somebody, what I need is I need someone who's got a lot of power. But what if they don't have much concern for me, right? So Dwayne The Rock Johnson, he doesn't know me. He should, but he doesn't know me. So he's strong, and if we were in the same room together, I'd be like, now there's a powerful guy. And if somebody comes up to me and starts pushing me around, I could yell, Dwayne, Rock. He wouldn't do anything. So as a result, I'm afraid. I should be afraid in that room, because even though he's strong, he's not going to help me at all. All right, what if there's somebody who's got lots of concern for me, right? But doesn't have much power. So like we're talking Justin Bieber here. He has a lot of concern for me. He seems like a nice guy, right? If you were in the room today, he'd be like, oh, okay, I really like you, Jeff. Okay, we're in a room, somebody gets all mad at us, and I'm like, who's going to help? And I look over to Bieber, and I'm like, oh, no. I don't think this is going to go well, all right? Like maybe you can use you as a shield or something. Is the rest not going to work? So I'm afraid, right? Because I don't have someone who has power to deal with it. But if I have someone who has both power to care for me and has concern to care for me, what's the result? My friend Nate, he's 6'8". I spent the last week at his house. 6'8", he's huge. If I'm with him anywhere and you start mouthing off to me, I'll get behind his shoulder and go, Nate, go get him. Just hide behind him the whole time. He's enormous and he loves me. And when I have someone like that with me, what happens? Well, I have boldness. Of course I have boldness. Okay, so here's the thing. You have a God who when the question is asked, how big is the universe? He stretches his hand and he says, yeah, about that big. He's the one who spoke the universe into place. Everything you see around you, he's the maker of heaven and earth. He can do anything. He has done everything. There's a sea in the way, don't care. I'll part it. Death, I'll raise it. He's done all of those things. Talk about power. He's the Rock. Yes, but listen now. It's not just that he has this strength. He's got concern as well. Listen, if you're a Christian, you need to understand. Your Christianity didn't begin when you got baptized. It began in eternity past when the God of the universe should have passed you by, but he marked you out instead and said, this one is mine. And he drew you to himself in time, and he surrounds you with his providence in such a way that you come to faith in him. You can't turn away. He woos you. And then he says, this one will be mine forever, and I will take the rest of your days on earth to chisel you, to make you into a trophy that I'm going to demonstrate to all the universe in all eternity what I can do with my grace. And he will put you on a pedestal and he will say, that is what I've done. And he will never leave you and he will never forsake you. No matter how far you run, he will chase you down because you're his. That power, with that concern, leads to, oh, I don't know. It's just so hard. I don't know. Maybe we should be careful. Oh, come on, man. Stop with the golf cart. It should make you bold in faith. Second, though, it should make you encouraged in pain. Because listen, I'll finish here. If God has power and concern for us and watches over us always, the painful things that happen to us cannot be a result of weakness on his part or indifference on his part. It's not because he can't deal with the harm, and it can't be because he doesn't want to deal with the harm. There has to be another reason that that difficulty, that harm is in your life. God himself must have permitted it in your life for some purpose, for some reason that fits within his care and his power. So no matter what it is, you should be able to say, all right. All right, I know you have power to stop it, and I know you have love. So if it's still happening, there's a reason here. I was flying back, of course, from Canada in the last week, and they put me in the back of the plane. They always do with the babies, right? They see me and say, yeah, you'd fit in the back of the plane with the babies. So I usually sit kind of right in front of them. And I don't mind. It's fine. But usually what happens with the babies is their parents have all the energy at the beginning. So they're taking care of them really well and all this stuff. But by the end of the flight, when the plane starts to descend into Chicago, the baby starts freaking out. Which I understand. You would understand that too, right? Here's your parent who's always cared for you, who's always had the power to take care of everything you need. There's never been a moment where you've been super hungry. Usually when you cry, they try to address the need. You know, if you soiled yourself, they took care of it, all of this stuff. And in this moment, though, you're descending, and they are sitting there holding you, and they can't do anything. Or it seems like they can't do anything. You're looking at them, and you're freaking out because your ears are popping, and you're like, ah! And you're looking at the eye of your parent, and the parent is just holding you and saying, it's okay, it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. And I thought to myself, isn't this basically the way that we are? Isn't this essentially the case when things go wrong in our lives? We're like this little kid who doesn't understand why it's happening, but God's like the parent who's like, look, here's the thing. I could have stopped us from getting on this plane. I could have cared enough, I guess, to stop us from getting on this plane, but if I did, we would never see Grandma. If I did, we'd never get to where we need to go. And so even though the child doesn't know the reason, there is one. There is one child. There is one. So you can be bold, but you can be encouraged. Because like a mother consoling her frightened child, God watches over us in the midst of even the hardest parts of our lives. There's none like him. Let me pray. Father, I'm thankful for your grace, your providence, your power, your care. I just don't think we know it well enough. So Lord, over the next weeks and months of our lives, would you convince us again? Would you help us to see how deep and wide and high and long is the love of Christ? And would that have an effect on our lives in all the appropriate ways, that our affections would be touched? It's not just something we think about, but our affections would be touched, no matter where we are, kind of on our own spiritual pilgrimage, on what stage we are walking up that hill to the temple of God. whether we're new to the faith or we're wondering whether we want to turn around and go back down or we've been following forever, Lord, would you show us once again, would you turn the diamond of the gospel once again, that it would shine brightly in our hearts and minds, Lord, that we would be changed and affected by it, that boldness would come, Father, and encouragement would come, Father, and joy would be the result. We ask it in Jesus' good name.